This video is brought to you by ClickUp. Batteries and energy storage are one of the most important sectors this decade. Everything from grid storage to electric cars, laptops, and phones hinge on their very development. But that historically means lithium-ion batteries, which requires exotic materials and we can't build them fast enough. But what if we could store energy without mining or building batteries, but instead by storing it in a rotating flywheel? Let's talk about flywheel energy storage and some game-changing breakthroughs in materials that could really take flywheels to the next level. I'm Ricky, and this is Tuba Da Vinci. I'm all about replacing fossil fuels with clean and renewable energy, but unlike coal and gas that you can modulate to produce electricity predictably, the sun shines differently throughout the day and the wind speeds vary too. So renewable energy is equal parts energy production and energy storage to help level out the variance in output. A recent study published by the International Journal of Renewable Energy suggests that we'll need to store at least 5% of the total renewable energy production capacity in order to replace fossil fuels completely. That means a lot of batteries. To give you an idea, in 2019 alone, we consume roughly 173,000 terawatt hours of energy, 85% of which came from burning fossil fuels. So we would need approximately 7,350 terawatt hours of energy storage to run a stable grid, assuming for the sake of argument that all that energy was used as electricity. That's an insane amount of energy capacity, enough to power 1 million average homes for almost 700 years, or charge a million Model 3 performance Teslas from 0 to 100% almost 90,000 times each. Considering that the worldwide energy capacity of today is approximately 9 terawatt hours, which is only 0.12% of what we would need, we have an uphill battle in front of us, and we need to take advantage of every storage technology available. And one promising solution is flywheel energy storage. Additionally, given that over 90% of our storage capacity comes from pumped hydro, and there are many places where this simply isn't an option, like Delaware and Mississippi, for example, we need alternative ways to store energy. In places where pumped hydro isn't an option, thermal energy batteries are the main competitors, followed by compressed air and flywheels coming in fourth, with a total deployed capacity of only a little over 97 megawatt hours. This would only be enough to power 3,300 average US homes for one day. Speaking of powering homes, let me give you a quick update on our going solar journey, which has been tricky, but our sponsor this week, ClickUp, has really helped. Here's a look at our workspaces for staying organized. Check it out. I think ClickUp could help you too. Whether it's your life and family or side hustle or your main business, ClickUp is an amazing tool for staying on top of it all. This is our video production schedule, where we plan future videos. Here's a sneak peek at what's coming up next week. We also have a board for our net zero home series, which is crucial because, well, it's pretty expensive stuff, so planning will be key. You can create custom properties like cost and then create custom views to see your data in different ways. Maybe I want to see our progress and where we are, or quickly see the same data organized by cost to figure out what we can tackle next. Plus, you can relate different spaces, allowing us to connect the home projects we need to do to their corresponding videos. Here's our roof replacement project. I can add photos and attachments to keep track of it all, and even mark it as a dependency for going solar. This is powerful stuff and can take your organization and productivity to the next level. Go to clickup.com, use code 2bit to get 15% off ClickUp's massive unlimited plan for a year. Then you can start reclaiming your time for under $5 a month. Huge thanks to ClickUp and you for supporting the show. Flywheels have amazing potential, and their storage capacity is growing exponentially. Only a few years ago, Beacon Power built one of the world's largest flywheel energy storage systems in New York that can pump out 20 megawatts for 15 minutes for a storage capacity of 5 megawatt hours. Another even bigger storage facility that'll hold 80 megawatt hours with a power rating of 20 megawatts is set to be built by a company called Amber Kinetics in Fresno County, California. Now, these are mostly bulky and heavy flywheels made for grid storage applications. But as we'll see later in the video, newer technology can make them lighter and more energy dense, making them ideal for mobile applications like EVs. In fact, flywheels are already used in Formula One cars to store excess mechanical energy. But what exactly are flywheel batteries? Flywheel batteries, or more accurately, flywheel energy storage systems, or FESs for short, are a type of electromechanical energy storage system. These systems transform one form of energy, like electrical energy, into rotational kinetic energy. At a fundamental level, a flywheel is pretty easy to understand. An electric motor uses energy to spin a massive rotor or flywheel, storing that electrical energy as kinetic energy in the spinning mass. These things can spin really fast. A modern flywheel is designed to spin at speeds upwards of 50,000 RPM. While the engine on a standard sedan will rarely go over 3,000 RPM while cruising on a freeway. The rotational kinetic energy remains in the flywheel as long as it spins at a constant speed. Then, when we want to discharge the flywheel, we use a generator to slow it down and convert the kinetic energy back into electrical energy, just like an EV's regenerative braking system does by slowing down the car. It's as simple as that. But how good are flywheels at storing energy? One way to know is by looking at its energy density. So let's see what that looks like for a flywheel. Thankfully, this is also quite easy to understand, and it's only based on a couple of simple equations. To get a better feel for this, let's put on our engineering hats and set to work on designing the world's greatest flywheel energy storage system by looking at how to maximize its energy density. As I just said, in a flywheel, energy is stored as rotational kinetic energy, which is given by the equation you see here, where I is the moment of inertia and omega is the angular speed, or how fast the flywheel is spinning, as in hertz or RPMs. This little formula basically tells us that we can increase the flywheel's energy by increasing the inertia or the angular speed, but the latter is more effective because it's squared. This means that if we double the speed, we'll multiply the kinetic energy by a factor of 4. The moment of inertia, on the other hand, depends basically on the flywheel's design or shape, its dimensions, and what it's made of, and it's usually a fixed quantity. So, to store more energy, we want to increase speed as much as possible because kinetic energy increases with the square of the angular speed. And we want to also increase the radius of the flywheel as much as possible because the moment of inertia also increases with the square of the radius. But there's a problem. You see, spinning faster and increasing the radius generates a great deal of tensile stress on the material that tries to rip it apart. If that stress becomes too high, the material will fail and the flywheel will really fly. Into pieces, that is. This is the typical optimization problem. We want to increase a good thing, like maximum speed and radius for more energy, but as we do, something bad also increases, like tensile stress in this case. Engineers already found the optimal solution for this problem, and it's summarized in a very simple equation that determines the maximum energy per unit mass of a rotating flywheel or its specific energy density. In this equation, K is a constant that depends exclusively on the rotor's shape. Its highest possible value is 1 for a special theoretical shape called the Laval disk. But we can get real values in the range of between 0.8 and 0.95 if we trim the Laval disk and add a rim. Here's some examples of K for other rotor shapes. The rest of the equation is the ratio of the material's maximum tensile resistance or yield strength, sigma max, to its density, rho. So the stronger and lighter the material, the more energy a flywheel can store while spinning at its maximum velocity without failing. We should note here that the real limiting factor in flywheel energy density isn't so much the flywheel's design, which in the best case would double the energy density, but rather the construction material. So what should we make our flywheel out of if we want to maximize energy density? This table here ranks flywheel construction materials based on their expected energy density calculated with the previous equation. Notice how a strong, lightweight metal like titanium offers an energy density of just 32 watt-hours per kilogram, which is about 1/10 of the energy density of Tesla's new 4680 cells. On the other hand, a cylindrical rotor made of T1000 carbon fiber composite can reach theoretical energy densities of 254 watt-hours per kilogram, making them as good as the best lithium-ion battery packs. So in principle, we could potentially even use these kinds of flywheels to power EVs. But it doesn't stop there. Notice how I blurred out the top row of this table? That's because I don't want to give away the number one spot just yet, but we'll get back to that in a bit. First, let's talk about the pros. Flywheels are encased in an inert, frictionless vacuum, meaning they require very little maintenance and can easily withstand 20 or more years of constant use. This makes them an almost set-it-and-forget-it energy storage system. Secondly, we can charge them with a high round-trip efficiency of 90% and more in a matter of seconds to minutes, depending on the total capacity, without generating almost any heat. You can't do that, for example, with lithium-ion batteries. Thirdly, flywheels can withstand 100,000 to a million charge and discharge cycles, including both shallow and deep cycles, without a hiccup. But one of the best things about flywheels, though, is their power density, which is second only to supercapacitors. You can draw almost as much power as you want from a flywheel without overheating it, making them great for covering peak electricity demand in power grids and other applications. But of course, flywheels aren't perfect. Most common flywheels have low energy densities compared to the best chemical batteries. They require precision milling and construction techniques to ensure the rotor is adequately balanced and the vacuum chamber doesn't have any leaks. This makes this technology rather expensive up front, especially considering the cost of high tensile strength carbon fiber and other novel materials. But of all these issues pertaining to flywheel energy storage, the worst by far is their energy loss in standby mode, which ranges from 3 to 20% per hour. This is a limiting factor that prevents using flywheels for long-term energy storage, and it's also the number one reason why we don't see flywheels absolutely everywhere. Even in the best cases, losing 3% of the charge per hour means losing all the charge in a little over a day. However, this still works for some mobile applications like EVs or the 1940s Swiss gyro bus, which charged for a couple of minutes in every station. I made a video about this that you should really check out, links in the description. In spite of these limitations, there is a new material called carbon nanotubes that is helping make flywheel batteries better than ever before. This is a form of carbon arranged into a hexagonal honeycomb structure rolled up into a tiny tube 1 to 2 nanometers thick. That's about 1/10,000th of the thickness of the thinnest human hair. It's also super light and incredibly strong. That said, it's time to unblur the table I showed you earlier. As you can see on this table, carbon nanotubes have the highest yield strength known to man, reaching a staggering 30,000 megapascals along their axis. That's over 20 times stronger than the strongest steel. This unique combination of tensile strength and low density is just what the doctor ordered to maximize a flywheel's energy density, which can reach almost 2,700 watt-hours per kilogram. That's 10 times more than the best chemical battery to date. Increasing a full order of magnitude in capacity will totally change the game in energy storage, and possibly shift a large chunk of funding towards improving other components of the system even further. There are still some challenges to address, like making these nanotubes long enough and in large enough quantities, but researchers are already able to produce 4S of carbon nanotubes 14 centimeters long. These could be long enough to build some pretty epic flywheels. If we manage to make them at a commercial scale, we'll have hit the flywheel of fortune jackpot. But the real problem comes down to scale of how much carbon nanotube material we can produce. Also, we need really long nanotubes because you don't want to have a bunch of little flywheels, because that means you have to have generators, motors, power controllers for thousands of different flywheels. The way this scales up and becomes cost effective is by having large flywheels that store a ton of energy. So to make a larger flywheel with a larger radius, you have to have these materials that can be built and stretched out longer than they currently are today. So while this is truly a theoretical promise, a future where we have carbon nanotubes means we'll have amazing flywheels, they are still practical today with current technology. So for flywheels to really take off and to be one of the most energy dense forms of storage, we got to make carbon nanotubes really big to make larger and larger flywheels. Otherwise, the cost just won't scale up. But even today, as it is with carbon fiber and with lightweight materials like titanium, we can make some pretty amazing flywheels. And their power response is an amazing application for grid storage to be able to take the peaks and valleys of energy demand and fulfill that with renewable energy. And so no, you wouldn't want a flywheel home battery, because hours later when the sun's gone down, it's probably going to be slowing down and lose all that energy. But it would make a ton of sense for grid operators. So that's where you'll most likely see it. But what do you think? Do you think flywheels are going to make a comeback? Do you think we're going to see a ton of new projects in development? There are some already all around the world. I'd love to know what you think. And if you thought that was really cool, you got to check out our video on the gyro bus next. I'm Ricky Tuba da Vinci. We'll catch you guys next week.